they know that ultimately
they're still working for somebody else.
Exactly right. That's exactly right. So it's like, that's always an ego check.
If it's not Haskell's way, it's no way at all, as we know, as we all found out.
Yeah, listen, if his legacy could be anything, if he could, we could still get that 12 on, 12 off that he was fighting for like crazy with that who needs sleep and all that stuff. I mean, that alone would be, that alone makes his, if that ever happens, which it should, that would be amazing.
Has the world of being a DP changed as you've been doing this now for a few decades?
Probably not as much as it, in my mind, it changed in the decades before I started being a DP in a way, because I remember just hearing stories about me. Like, I'll give you an example, is like Fame, right? Remember they remade Fame? Mm-hmm. And the first Fame is awesome. I admittedly have not seen the second Fame, but I know people worked on it.
Yeah.
The first Fame, I think, shot for 92 days. And the second Fame, which is basically the exact same movie, shot for like 40 days. And you're like, well, wait, they're the same movie. Like, back then, you'd have 90 days to shoot a movie, and it was usually just one crew, maybe single camera. And now we make, that's my phone, of course. Now we make movies we just throw more and more manpower and make them in shorter and shorter time. But I think in my experience, when I started shooting movies, you know, certainly movies of some size, it feels similar ever since. Maybe now there's even more of that downward pressure. The time you have with actors is even less and less. And I think the idea that now we make movies in even less and less time with more and more second unit, splinter unit, you know, just keep throwing cameras and units at it, I think has continued to progress in that direction.
So have you often made movies for studios that where you are the only DP on the movie? There's always a second unit, I guess.
Well, Todd's movies, we've rarely even had second units. We've had a little bit for just some heavy action stuff, but rarely. And every time we always a little bit go, let's do it like Nolan does it, like just one crew, one camera, as much as we can. We always shoot with two cameras. We're different than Nolan in that regard. But man, I love that Nolan shoots his own inserts and shoots his own aerials and does all those things. And so certainly Joker would be an example of us, you know, there's no second unit, there's no splinter unit, I went up and shot the aerials, you know. So all of that, we tried to do our best version of making it feel like one of those. In that regard, it's like we did want to make it like a movie of the 70s or 80s, in that it's a very singular, not sort of bifurcated by all these different sort of resources.
So you've done a bunch of movies with, I don't know if you've done all of Todd's movies, but you certainly did a bunch of them.
I didn't do Old School or School for Scoundrels or Road Trip, but I did the last six movies over the last 11 years.
So how early do you have the conversation that Joker is something and start thinking about it?
Right when he sends me the script, basically.
But is that, I mean, how far into the process is that?
That was a good year and a couple months before we shot it. So, you know, right when he basically got a draft that he knew was good enough for him to say, this is my next movie, that's when he sent it to me, and that's when we had the conversation about shooting it. And then the conversation started about, like, what's it going to be? And I think even then, I feel like our early conversation was like, yeah, let's do it single camera. Even though, in a way, and this may be more me, is like I like to have that second camera as almost an experimental camera. It can be a little bit like the first camera and the A camera can be somewhat more conservative and tell the story in the way that maybe is point A position and in that point of view. But the B camera can kind of sometimes just get something that's a little bit more adventurous. So even, you know, we tried to make the movie as single camera as possible. We often shot with two cameras as well.
Well, in this movie in particular, where Joaquin is so much the center of it, it's unusual that way as a movie, that it's, you know, capturing what he's doing and the variety of what he's doing must have been one of the biggest challenges. You're really like, it seems like a different experience than doing a straight script where you're, you know, doing coverage more traditionally and everything else. It seems like, you know, capturing it is really...
Absolutely. You really nailed it, that it's such a singular story about one man.
Yeah.
And just the nature of making a movie about one guy means that, you know, you're often sitting in a room with one actor. So you're not doing traditional coverage because there's no one to cover it against.
Right.
And so it's really freeing in that it allows you to maybe just be a bit more experimental and lyrical. And I think in that regard, it was the most satisfying experience because it allowed for so many more of those opportunities. You know, in a way, it has some similarities to Garden State in that Garden State also only has the character is your sort of entry point to every single scene, and every single character you meet is through that character. There's never a scene that exists without Andrew Largeman. There's never a scene that exists without Arthur Fleck.
It seems like that Zach and
Todd.
I'm only blanking on Todd's name, but are rather different kinds of comedy and even drama directors, to say the least. They're such different personalities.
Yeah, well, I mean, obviously Zach is also an actor and acted in the two movies I've done with him. Todd, although, has acted and did a cameo in, I think, three of our six movies. They're similar in some ways. They're certainly different in a lot of ways, but their similarities are that they both care about movies being visually, like the visuals matter to them, and not every director does. And so sometimes you're always servicing the director first and foremost, and so the style and the end result of the movie is always going to be a reflection of what's important to the director.
Is that increasingly so with Todd, or is that something that's always been there and it's just kind of emerged more dramatically in this case?
I felt like it was always there with Todd. I remember just seeing a little touches of that in Old School, which I love and wasn't a part of. But I could see little bits of that just felt slightly different than your average comedy director. Mm-hmm. Whether it was just his ability to just go, I like it a little dirty, and I like it a little real, I like this uncorrected fluorescent thing here. He did some handheld work inside the car with Will Ferrell, driving around, when he's calling his ex-wife. And little touches of those kind of, whether it's indie style mixed in with a studio film, that I appreciated even watching it from afar before I even met him. And so I knew early on in Hangover that it mattered to him.
Right.
That if we said, oh, let's shoot this scene at dusk, or let's shoot this over two afternoons because the light would be better, that he would go for it. And that matters because it only further emboldens you to realize that it's not just jokes and it's not just this specific performance thing, but that the whole movie matters and that he's trying to make something that's cinematic. And that comes, he's also a fantastic editor, and he does something that I feel like is really rare.
He drops bombs.
I mean, it's the fires, and they're probably
El Baghdadi is here somewhere in your basement, in your garage.
Oh, that's an old plane, too.
Santa Monica Airport has mostly old planes.
Is that one thing that Todd does great is, you shoot coverage in a movie, and we tend to shoot a decent amount, partly because we work really quickly and we like to have some variety of things. But, we'll shoot masters and we'll shoot wide shots. We'll shoot shots that maybe are just serving for geography. And not every director is able to weave those in a way that doesn't just feel either super traditional, like let's start in the wide and move in closer, or don't use it at all because the joke isn't great there and they're just servicing the joke, let's say. Mm. Todd is amazing at using coverage and really kind of fitting in the best moments without it ever feeling like he's doing it to get those things. It's something I admire immensely, even having directed myself. So how hard that is to do and not, because you're always servicing, let's say, the acting first and foremost, right? You want to make that drive everything. But to also fit in those other cinematic pieces is something he does really well.
When you think of Hangover, you don't really think of jokes. I mean, it's a comedy, obviously, but it's you think of set pieces, and that's, when people talk about the movie and what they remember, it's always kind of this broader set piece that,
perfect way to describe it. It's exactly right. It's not jokes. It's not jokes on a page. I always say, it's not necessarily even the script. It's about setting up the scenario. It's about setting up a environment in which a bunch of funny things happen, and then within that. So the environment might be these guys are going to have to make a deal to get out of the police by getting tased. And that environment then sets up the three or four huge laughs or four or five huge laughs in that scene, and so on and so forth throughout. And so, unlike somebody who's sort of from the back behind the monitors lobbing a bunch of alt jokes, Todd never does that.
Yeah.
His thing is how do we make the scene work? And we often will almost always run it from top to bottom So the scene has to work as a whole. And then when we shoot coverage, we'll run the whole scene. We're not running it just for that joke. We're not retaking it just for that joke. We're running the whole scene so that it always feels like it has opportunities to discover new things within the confines of like this setup, right? This set piece that's being set up.
And of course, Todd is maybe the most infamous of the DP30 interviews in that he, on Hangover 2, attacked me for not thinking Hangover 1 was going to do as much business as it did.
Oh, did he
enraged
really?
At me, yes. He called me the worst journalist ever, and that was a piece of shit, and all kinds of stuff. He was a little drunk. He was drinking wine during the interview.
That's hilarious.
Yeah.
Wait a second. So there's a, I'm going to confess something very small, which in a weird way has a tie in directly to that, which is, because I got turned on to you, I think, through Movie City News and something. And I don't know why. I think I was probably staying up late playing online poker and just fiddling around the internet. And I found something where you made a prediction that Garden State was not, it was going to be one of the long-standing big sales at Sundance. So it wasn't going to do well. And I think I literally, I never do this. I think I've never done this in my life, partly because you scared me away from it. Is I wrote an email. I was like, Poland, how about that for how's your prediction now? Something very innocuous. And to your credit, you, I think all you wrote back was, fair enough, DP.
That sounds like me.
But when you wrote DP, I didn't think David Poland. I thought, holy shit, he's calling me out because he knows I'm the DP. And I like was like, this is why I'm never going to respond.
Funny.
I like you were basically going, yeah, you're the DP. Of course you're going to support this thing. So it's funny. I did not know that thing about Todd, but I guess we did both did the same thing where we're like a little bit like, come on, you had you of little faith, not knowing that we're going to like we're going to crush it.
Well, I liked Hangover, but we did an interview with Todd at my place like a week before it opened, and he was very, very nervous. And because there was all this predictions that it was going to be huge, 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 and he wasn't really sure. And so I was like, well, I think it's going to do $100 million, whatever, not 200, 300. And he was like, he was nervous. And so he was very angry by the time he gets. And the second movie, I predicted the number. I was the only person who predicted the number dead on. I hit the domestic and the international exactly before it came out. He never acknowledged that.
Well,
so
I
now
remember,
you see him at the bagel shop, and he like goes, hey, David. I'm like, hey, Todd.
It's weird that way. I mean, listen, nobody could have predicted the
He was trying to figure out how to get me out of the business.
Oh, my God.
He literally asked me how much it would cost to buy the site for me to shut it down and never work again. And he didn't pay me, though.
Amazing.
I didn't get the check. Now I might get the check.
That doesn't surprise me that Todd said that.
Yeah. So was the first conversation 70s on this, or?
Not so much. It was a little bit of like, because it's set in 1981, I think is what the script actually says.
Yeah.
There were conversations about just obviously building the world of that era, right? Mm-hmm. And then of course, because there's elements of the story that make you remind people, and certainly it's hard not to think of something like Taxi Driver or King of Comedy.
Mm-hmm.
But it was less about the look of the 70s movies and more about the way those 70s movies were made, that handmade feel. I think that was the main thing. It was like, let's make this feel handmade. Let's not, even though we're making a studio movie, even though we're making something that is works within the IP of DC, let's make something that just feels like it could have been made in the 70s or 80s. That was the main thing, really.
So that shot behind the curtain, before he's going on the talk show, is very Carson.
Oh,
very
yeah.
specific.
Well,
that color,
but by the way,
that curtain.
Absolutely. And that's a large part Mark Friedberg and all the ways in which during the testing, and we go through a bunch of just like, you know, during prep, we're constantly looking at examples of like, what did Carson do back then? And that sometimes that's just anthropological. It's just like, let's look at the research and find those behind the scenes. I remember watching some YouTube video where they went behind the scenes at Carson and seeing that actual like behind the scenes. And they actually, I think, had a mirror there and what that is. And a lot of it's just trying to be as authentic as we can to what we're doing, which is, okay, he was basically the Carson of his time, Murray Franklin.
Yeah.
And
though people are, that curtain is specific to, I think, people over 45, probably the only people who know that curtain
that's
existed,
right.
That color.
Yeah,
it was
yeah,
this
yeah.
series of, you know, that, that
the stripes.
The
stripes
of that
color.
Were,
yeah, and ours are obviously
so
different colors, but they're very patterned after that Carson look, for sure.
It brings out that thing. How much conversation are you getting into? I mean, is it kind of clear enough from the script what it is that he's wanting after you've had the conversation about what the style
it's
might
strange.
Be?
Or? Our conversations happen more when we're scouting locations, and then it'll be one question back and forth. Like, obviously, we have less and less conversations, more movies we make together, and a lot of it is on location scouting, we're discovering what the movie is or what the movie isn't. Mm-hmm. And so every time we visit a location, that's where a lot of the back and forth happens, in which I'm either discovering where his head is, he's discovering where my head is, and I think that's in large part where the movie's look and feel gets discovered. Mm-hmm. I tended to use a lot of screen grabs and other things to have conversations. I actually even developed a website just to do this, right? Mm-hmm. Called Shot Deck, which is it's basically a database of screen grabs in which then it can become a conversation starter about color or composition or, look and feel of things. Mm-hmm. And so often we'll use that. I'll use that with the production designer and we'll compare notes, and we're constantly having the conversation. It's like a conversation that starts on day one of prep or even before that, and every single day you're sort of putting new information into a set of boxes that maybe go, this is the look of the movie.
Did anything change significantly from that first day, or?
Not really. I think it changes so incrementally. It's you don't really see it until it's already sort of gone, or it's sort of already shifted into a new place.
Yeah.
I remember the stairs were a big part, the actual the grounding place of what is Arthur's world. In large part came down to where is his world? Mm. And we were really comparing two locations. There was actually a traditional tenement in Brooklyn that had sort of three rising towers with a big courtyard and these kind of these little lobbies that were really intriguing and interesting looking. And was comparing that against the stairs. And then and I think Todd kept returning in his original intent, which is I just always imagined it was in an environment that wasn't so flat. Mm. And that he loved the fact that there was so much elevation in the Bronx, and that then it wasn't your traditional sort of flat, Brooklyn or lower Manhattan look.
I think Billy Friedkin's probably pissed off at you guys because you've taken away his stairs.
I know,
He's now the second most popular stair. I mean, I'm sure his stairs are still extremely popular.
Yeah.
But your stairs are now becoming legends. A thing.
Like a real thing.
Yeah.
I was saying there was a 5-bedroom apartment at the top of those stairs being sold when we were making it. I was like, could have just opened a Joker museum. Just bought it.
Or just waited until after the movie came out to sell the movie. Sell the apartment.
Or just have a place so people could Airbnb and hang out at the stairs and look at it.
You can be at the stairs.
Exactly.
Industrious. Was that kind of intentional? Was there a sense that there was something iconic about that particular set piece?
I don't think, we certainly thought that the stairs had, we shot tests at the stairs. So we were shooting, when we started the movie, we were going to shoot on film, and then it sort of transitioned into shooting in large format digital. So we shot those stairs probably 3 or 4 times just during prep. Hmm. I would bring a still camera there, then I'd bring a film camera there, then I brought film and digital there. So we were on the stairs a lot. The people that lived in that neighborhood saw us a lot, even before we shot one frame. And then we shot the actual footage in the movie way late in the schedule because we wanted the leaves to be dead and to feel a little bit more sort of less full of life. Mm-hmm. So that stairs and shooting the stairs was a big part of just the thought of we scheduled around the dusk and all these other things around those stairs. But I don't think we thought it would become a religious, destination. We didn't think it would have people dancing on them now. We always knew that the dancing was going to be cool, but it was more because of the celebration and the dance that Joaquin and Joker were going to portray. I don't think I ever thought, even when we were shooting it, that it was going to become the thing that it was going to become, or Joaquin that it would become the poster and all these things.
Well, Joaquin had already done a lot. If you were shooting late, Joaquin had already done a lot of dancing.
Yes.
For you.
Yeah. He had done tons, and there were even some things that were in the original script where there were even more dancing that we didn't shoot. But
so it could be an extra on the DVD. It was like the extra dancing of Joaquin Phoenix.
There are scenes we did shoot that are wonderful, but I don't think there will ever be a deleted scenes ever. Huh. I just don't think Todd. He likes the integrity of the movie as it stands,
right.
And I think it's not one of those movies that would have that. But there's some wonderful scenes.
Has he done extra stuff?
I think back when DVDs really drove the marketplace, they just don't drive it in the way. So, people are so bonkers over this movie and love talking about it and having conversations that in a weird way, even though Blu-rays don't really sell in the way they used to, a Blu-ray of this, if it had an actual commentary section, would probably do pretty well because there is this fever for people having information and more things, you know, deconstructing it, learning more about how it was made. I just don't know if that even still has a place in the market anymore.
It doesn't, but every once in a while it happens because it's interesting to the people. What would really be interesting to do, like Todd's, you know, commentary during the movie, and then have people who, critics who love the movie, and then have critics who hate the movie.
Why not? Right, exactly.
And, you know.
Yeah, and just let them
get it all.
Out.
Everybody chew
that's
it
right.
up, chew
that's
on it.
That's right. And they feel, see all the perspectives.
Yeah.
And, you know, Hangover was actually, interestingly enough, in this sort of six movie span that Todd and I have had together, was kind of at the dying end of DVD sales. It was a right. massive DVD seller. It was one of the biggest ones of Warner Brothers, like, and it really was right when they stopped selling. And
yeah.
so, I don't know, it's interesting. Who knows what Warner's has in mind, but they probably could ship some Blu-rays on this
movie.
Well,
now you have HBO Max Plus, or whatever they're calling it.
Yeah.
Today, it'll change by next week, I'm sure. But yeah, it could be like an entire section on the Joker.
Who knows?
Just Joker.
Yeah, that's right. Like a little subcategory.
We have to be careful.
Sub-channel.
That we're not showing age by saying the Joker instead of Joker.
Yeah, that's right.
Because that's usually what happens as you get older, is everything has a the in front of it, even if it doesn't.
Well, that's what my mom does. We're here in Venice, but or near Venice, and there's a place called Rose Cafe.
Mm-hmm.
She calls it the Roses. Every time. Every time.
See, it's
true.
She's
like, every vague, she changes the pronouns. With it's amazing. And I go, I guess that's also my destiny in about 20 years, too.
So did you guys, it seems like you guys were left to your own devices on this picture once it got going. And there wasn't really a lot of pressure.
Is amazing in that he's always left to his own devices. Whether it's like a force of his will, the fact that he's obviously had some successes and he deserves to like be sort of trusted.
Mm-hmm.
I think the hardest thing about making this movie was getting it actually to the start line.
Mm-hmm.
There was definitely like, you know, forces within and just other people that were like, this is a challenging movie. Will it work? R-rated, singular, sort of like, I think that's one of the reasons it's at the price point that we made it for.
Mm-hmm.
It was not an easy movie to get greenlit, as Todd, I'm sure, can attest. but once we started making the movie, it's been the same for all six movies with Todd. Amazingly, the mm-hmm. least amount of studio interference, and certainly from where I sit, there may be conversations Todd's having at night over things
right.
that, of course, I'm not privy to, but I never see any sort of things that are coming from another force above that are sort of making us make changes or affecting things. It's really, it's great, and I think it's one of the reasons why Warner's has genuinely been known as like a filmmaker-friendly studio that really, they give Nolan and they give Ben Affleck and they give Todd, they give them opportunities to do what they do and not try to interfere early on as much as they can.
A little more trouble on the last movie with
hey,
Ben, but
listen, it's like that's the thing, you take the good and the bad, like that book Final Cut, you know, about hey, the making of Heaven's Gate.
That's right? Why it's nobody like, will let me on a set. It's like it's bad luck to have a journalist writing about your movie. I'm like, okay.
I know, it's always intriguing. I always thought like I wished there was an unbridled, it's one of those weird things. I was always intrigued by making movies. They're never really great movies about making movies.
Mm-hmm.
I remember like Dangerous Game with Harvey Keitel and Madonna. Remember that movie?
Yes, not, I do.
But it's like, there's something about, you know, somebody who obviously has spent their whole life making movies.
Yeah.
I'm intrigued by the sort of, the making of them as well as what we're actually, you know, putting on screen.
Yeah.
And I always thought, I wish there was a version in which you could, you know, make like a behind the scenes historical sort of like, you know, now they'll do an oral history, but they do a history as you're making it, but you know, unrestricted and really see it and then release it 10 years after the movie. But you can only release it 10 years after the movie. You can't release it
on
before.
The same day and date. Now, I actually, that's one of the things, I mean, in terms of my stuff and people, we've talked about doing documentaries before, and I'm like, there are two documentaries I've wanted to do, and one is that thing, and I'm friendly with certain directors, but I'm like, they're really not interested having somebody on their set for the entire time and really seeing everything that's going into making the sausages. And the other thing was doing junkets. And I thought, particularly because I think the junket era is ending,
right.
you know, is in the process of dying as more and more outlets repeat the same thing over and over again and aren't really looking for unique content.
Yeah.
There's no point in flying 50 people to a city to talk about a movie. It's kind of silly. So I figure it's going to die soon enough, and like it'd be great to do like a junket weekend. And I was like, I'd give the talent, you know, clear things out for the talent so they can say no to something if they want to. I mean, I'm willing to bend over backwards. And I have friends at certain studios who I'm like really friends with, and they're like, no, can't can't even think about it. It's not a realistic even conversation.
Right. I know.
We would never let you have a camera in that room because we would lose control of it, and that would be it.
But it would be super fascinating. Yeah. In our world where we like to see the kind of reality behind the facade.
Project Greenlight or whatever.
Well, but that was kind of Project Greenlight did it the wrong way, right? Yeah. And I was intrigued by that, and I have my own little experience with that, but it's hidden away in like the annals. But it is that they spent the whole project telling you the movie was a disaster, and then in the last episode,
they go on to see the movie,
and they actually in the last episode they're always like, "But it's pretty good," and I'm like, "But you just spent the whole thing, and they did it wrong." I go, "Well, you should just." Release the movie,
right.
Try to make a good movie, hopefully it's a pretty good movie, and then show the sort of sausage being made, right? Like, flip it. And that's where it was like, well, what if you did that with a movie that then was either a great success or even something that didn't work, right? Like,
right.
I could pick a movie out of a hat and say that would be really interesting. Like, I could go, well, if you told me you had a definitive oral history of how Sideways was made, and you could see, like, just, particularly if there's some, you know, heat underneath it.
Yeah.
In the same way as, like, the Redux or Apocalypse Now, sort of like the behind-the-scenes stuff that his daughter was shooting. It's fascinating.
Yeah.
Or his wife.
Eleanor.
Or maybe it was on The Shining or something. Like, yeah. I remember seeing that behind-the-scenes clip of The Shining documentary.
Right.
Where you see Kubrick like searching for that low angle shot, and you're like, "That's as a filmmaker, it's like candy."
Well, Eleanor's film of Hearts of Darkness, the documentary, is one of the greatest documentaries ever. And then there's a great one about making Fitzcarraldo.
Exactly.
And then Werner made one about himself, which of course was full of falsehoods, but
or
that's because it's Werner.
The one about about making Don Quixote, right?
Yes, and now they have a sequel.
That's right.
So that's actually just opening at Doc Week this week.
Yeah.
Actually.
So it's like when they actually do give you something that feels unrestricted, or
Yeah,
amazing. Yeah. Right.
Lost in La Mancha is one
Lost
most painful things to watch ever.
It's
movies.
Interesting. I it's hard because obviously you stick cameras in there and. People, but
but
they get comfortable
very good
enough,
about, like,
of course. And I wish there, one on the Joker would be amazing.
Yeah,
it doesn't exist, so we'd have to fake it. Yeah, exactly.
Well, the EPK business is also that's kind of evolved and devolved as well, so it's kind of like become very staid because they used to be more interesting. If you like look on MGM, cable, they'll have some of the stuff from like the 40s and 50s and 60s and stuff where they were like junkets were really like. Involved where people were actually communicating. It was kind of fascinating.
Yeah,
and the talent would sit there and say something.
Oh, but now it's like nobody wants to
they're
do
scared to
EPKs?
Death
yeah
they're
exactly.
scared
and they restrict how many days they can be on set and,
and they restrict how many hours they'll do junkets even
that's
and it's
right
like, because I do a half an hour it's like it goes against the junket rules because they're trying to squeeze everybody in so we rarely shoot on junket days because people freak out that I'm getting too much time. And then they're screaming and yelling. God forbid that the world comes to an end. Though Steven Soderbergh is, I will say, has taken on longer form interviews, and he blames me for it. He blamed me for it at least once. So I'm proud of that. He won't do like short form anymore. He only does half an hour or more.
I love Soderbergh so much.
Yeah.
I think it's.
He does not want anybody in his sets either. Because he'd be the perfect person to do it. I mean, it'd be kind of a brilliant thing to watch
because,
it work.
Yeah, exactly. See how somebody
shooting
who
also,
does it all.
And,
yeah, I would be interested. I'd want to watch.
See Marianne Bernard up close.
Making these iPhone movies.
Yeah,
I want to see
all of it. Have you tried the iPhone thing? Have you thought
I'm
about it?
No, I'm about to embark on something similar, and so I'm seeing it as just purely like this immense challenge. I've. Have an 11 and I'm messing around with it. And
your three cameras, your three lenses.
Yeah, I don't know. Honestly, I'm just sort of trying to sort of crack it a little bit, but it's intriguing. But the biggest thing is, we shot Joker on Alexa 65, which is one of the largest sensors they have out here. And what you realize is like a phone has the tiniest sensor. It's literally it's the extreme of the scenario. And that sort of infinite depth of field is, I think, the hardest part about the camera.
And is it hard? Have they gotten to the point where the Alexa 65 is relatively easy to use? Or?
Oh, it's just simple to use.
Simple to use.
Yeah. It's just it's proprietary. They did Arri did a similar thing to what Panavision did for years, which is they made that camera proprietary to them,
right.
So you can't buy it, which makes it then, I guess, you know, it's a brilliant business model for them because it's such a great camera, but they're in control of that camera. Yeah. I can't have one, otherwise I'd have one in my garage right now.
And you have no interest in shooting at 120 frames per second or anything like that? Is that...
You know what, until I see, let's say, Gemini Man at that frame rate, my guess is no.
Yeah.
From what I've seen with Hobbit and what I've seen with Billy Lynn, and I'm still not sure why that makes it better. So my instinct is
I'm not sure that
no.
Ang Lee knows why it makes it better.
Yeah, Ang Lee is to me one of those like rare filmmakers that has done every single genre that's available on film and has made just amazing. I mean, Ice Storm alone, the fact that he directed that is amazing. Yeah. It feels experimental. It's interesting. The thing I like about shooting and is that it has this sort of combination of art and technology. Mm-hmm. But whenever the technology feels like in any way, like it's having power over the thing you're shooting in the moment, I get really nervous. Suddenly, whether that's like something that's really hard focus wise or some really complicated camera move that takes 15, 16 takes. Mm. It always feels like then this is wrong. If this is so technical, then suddenly we're all just robots servicing a technical thing. And so the technology driving it, in the same way as motion capture and some of the stuff that Zemeckis was doing, it just always felt like that was driving it,
right,
instead of like a movie like Castaway, where even if there's technology in the movie, it's always just like Tom Hanks on an island, right? And
that's how I felt about Gemini Man. I felt like he got captured by the 120 frames per second and the digital character, and that he really altered how he would have shot certain things. And that you could feel it didn't. It was like it was just a little off. And besides whether it looked cool or not, you know, I was just even like how he did action sequences, for instance, and the fact that he shot a lot of dark scenes because he realized, I think, from Billy Lynn that doing that in the light. In that big light they had in the stadium was just not a good idea, didn't play right. And the close-ups that he did in Billy Lynn, he did more of those.
Well, it's similar to like the 3D thing, right? Like forever we were being told 3D is like, it's here. And then when you'd say, when we, like you and I, like we'd go, we don't like it. They go, you're too old. Kids love it. And then my son, who's 8 years old, is like, I don't want to see something in 3D. And you go, well, wait, so now nobody, like you go, you can't force feed this thing to us. And then when they started saying like, okay, you can shoot 3D, but here are the rules. Then you suddenly go, whoa, if you're giving me all these rules, same thing with digital shooting. Yeah. When there are all these rules, you go, no, do this. When you have no rules, come back and then you're ready. And that's why people, I think, started shooting things and then converting them to 3D because filmmakers were like, these are too many rules.
Well, it's also cheaper.
Well, for sure.
And then of course animation, but they kind of foisted on the kids and early in the 3D thing, I was kind of against I didn't see a great future for it. It was, you know, you started looking at the percentage of screens count that was being shown in 3D, and it's gotten smaller and smaller and smaller because people really don't want to, they don't want to pay an extra $6 for it, and they don't really necessarily like it.
Well, that's the thing. At the end of the day,
every once in a while, there's a movie where it's worth seeing.
For sure.
Like Avatar.
Avatar, I agree.
Extraordinary.
I agree. And I thought there were some amazingly, like, elegant versions of it. Like, Hugo is a gorgeous, like, executed movie and really beautiful, but not enough for me to like necessarily go, I want to shoot a movie in that
I'm
way.
Having that thing about The Irishman and the aging,
right,
where I'm like,
although I saw it and I didn't get thrown by the DAG.
See, before I kind of gave up on worrying about it, but the first time I was like, the entire time I was trying to figure out, okay, is he 50, is he 38?
Well, I did get a little bit of that where I was wondering what age he was.
Yeah.
Like, it wasn't that clear, but I wasn't as thrown by maybe some of the things I'd read in advance.
And then when he physically moves like a 75-year-old, but his face is 50, I'm like, that's weird. Like,
well, that I think is the hardest part, right?
Yeah.
Is that your body isn't suddenly 25
years old. Marty shot it like he wasn't doing it,
right?
You know, and he just kind of...
That, I think, is one of those challenges. You go, we can fix the face, but then wait, like we still have
a 70-year-old guy throwing a gun off a... bridge.
Yeah. How good is Pacino, though? I thought Pacino was
well, they're all. And for me, Pesci, I'm like, all I want to do is like sit there and look at Pesci's face.
I know.
Because the lines have gotten so interesting. He's kind of this beautiful artifact.
Well,
now.
And also just not seeing him for however many years is pretty great.
But he's gone from like, he was always odd looking, but now he's like, the lines are so deep. It's like some, it's almost like, I don't know, some sort of churrascure or something.
Right.
So what was the hardest thing about Joker? Was there anything that was like, oh, this is really tough, or was it just everything normally tough?
I think it was just a really, it was a movie in which Todd and I were pushing each other really hard. Like, I think that was ultimately the trickiest thing, was that every day Todd and I were really just challenging each other in a way that was great and always fulfilling, but challenging, right? And I think in the end, like, that pressure we put on each other to not compromise and to sort of not just play something down the middle created something we were both immensely proud of. And so in the end, that was like totally worth it. But the challenges day to day were all like movie making challenges, right, which were fun, you know? And some of those are more technical things and figuring out a solution to like shooting the subway and you know, where the killings happen and how do you do those? But those are the kind of fun challenges of just, okay, we have a result that we're trying to get to, and how do we get there within the confines of the budget and other things like that.
Do you fall in love with shots on your movies? Is there like a shot?
There's one shot in the movie that's not in there that I fell in love with. And I even now I'm like, I never asked Todd to ever put a shot in, ever. Because I'm like, it's not me. That's right. I trust him so much as an editor, if nothing else, and a filmmaker, that I was like, I should have probably. But he explained why, because he knew. It's like a wide shot when he's getting fired in that phone booth, right after the hospital. And there's two wide shots that never got used. And you see the whole Brooklyn Bridge, and he's this tiny little beacon of yellow light in the sea of just like city grime, and you know, it just was like a world building shot, but also his loneliness that within the dailies that I loved. When we shot it, I loved it. When I watched it again in dailies, and it's not in the movie. So that's it's the only shot I love that's not in the movie.
It sounds like it needs to get blown up and put on your wall.
I don't even know how I get
a portrait of it.
It's funny. I should figure out some way to get it. Yeah.
So is being a DP everything you thought it was going to be when you started?
It's more. Yeah, I don't know what I thought when I sort of set out to do it, honestly. I knew that it was something I was super into. I fell in love with filmmaking late in college, and then moved right out to LA, and was like, a natural progression was to shoot, because I liked still photography, and so I had a certain level of acumen, and it was natural. And then I was like, let me be a DP, but I didn't know it would be as sort of fulfilling and satisfying as it is, and that it would provide the challenges every single movie that is still really fun. I've directed before, I want to direct again. That was also really satisfying. That has a whole level of other things that has made me now really compassionate and empathetic for every director I've ever worked with. But in a way, shooting is more simple and fun and satisfying. Directing has so much more other complications involved. So DPing, I think it's the greatest job in the world. You're at the center of the storm, you know.
And are you competitive? Do you like look at other people's work?
No, I'm jealous of everybody else's work. I'm definitely not competitive. I'm still learning what I'm doing and really sort of working my way up. But more, I'm just
working your way up. How much bigger are you gonna get?
I mean, just think about like opportunities to shoot more interesting things with more interesting people and directors that I admire. So I always, every year there's a movie that I'm like, that movie's so beautiful. And I'm really admire the attack that they took on the movie you know. I there's a lot of good work, so it's like there's a lot of really talented people.
Well, you do seem to like repeat directors, which is a good thing, I was thinking.
Yeah, I think certainly you want to have like repeat customers.
It's like Mike Giacchino always has like, he has his group and he repeats with them, and he'll do his, their smallest movies and their biggest movies.
Yeah.
But he works with the same, you know, four or five, it keeps on expanding a little bit, but he's very committed to those people. It's like he just wants to stick with his group of people he loves and likes working with.
Well, I think filmmaking and filmmaking crews are some of the most interesting people around in that they highly specialized skills, and they're often coming from all these disparate worlds, and they come together to make something, and many times never met or even worked with each other. You know, certainly worked with each other, but often maybe didn't even meet, and then now they're suddenly all together making something in which they're all collaborating. And I think the opportunity that you have to do it again with the same person, it's one less thing that's an unknown, right? You're, like, everything about filmmaking is in a way to control the world that you're building. And so the people in which you're making it with is one less thing that maybe you can count on, even if it's the devil you know.
Right.
Right? It's true. Because, you know, you see them more than your family often, mm-hmm. and you fight with them just like a family would, and you love them the same way you love your family. And so it's a relationship that, you know, my relationship with Todd is as close as any relationship I have in this world, you know.
Well, from one DP to another.
Yeah, there
Thank you
go.
For your time.
The original DP.
The original DP for the DP.